Go away.
Are you alright?
No. Go away.
Mister, come on. Get up. Come on.
Is morning yet?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm fine. Leave me alone. I'm fine, okay?
Yeah.
Want some?
I'm trying to help. No, thanks. Sure.
Have some. What do you want?
Nothing. I'm just trying to help. I mean, I can't figure out why you're sitting here with no coat or anything on. It's freezing out here.
I'm fine. I like it out here.
Yeah, I can tell. You look like you're used to sitting out in the middle of a vacant lot sucking on a bottle of wine.
Is it that obvious?
Yeah, well, I mean, if you were used to that, you'd at least have some shoes on your feet. You must be some kind of fruitcake.
Well, I used to be a television personality.
Oh, yeah, that explains it. What do you mean, used to be? What did... Lousy ratings?
No, I don't know. I don't remember what happened.
Come on, stop being an asshole.
Not being an asshole. I don't remember, okay? Look, I just got hit over the head or something, and I don't know, and I woke up, and I'm here in this empty lot, and I don't remember what I used to do or anything. I just told you all I remember. I used to be on television, okay? You gotta trust me on that.
Well, okay, let's think about this. What is the last thing you remember?
Last thing I remember. I remember, I used to do some program for public access cable. Oh God, I must have been really desperate. Oh no.
Public access cable, isn't that the one that has all those religious programs?
Yeah, that's the one.
You don't look like a preacher to me.
Yeah, well, I probably wasn't a preacher. I must have done something else. I don't remember what I did. Wasn't a preacher, that's for sure.
Well, maybe you, used to work at Balois Restaurant at 1518 East...
Don't do that! Don't do that! Don't say that.
Why not?
I don't remember why not. It's just something about how I'm not supposed to give the address of any restaurant on the air because it violates Chicago Access Company's long-standing policy against advertising or solicitation of funds in any form whatsoever because it violates the principle of public access cable broadcasting and the ethics therein for me to advertise any business, and by giving the address I might be somehow encouraging you to buy their product, and I must not do that on the air.
Wow.
Oops.
Are you sure you weren't a lawyer?
No, no, go away. You're bringing back some unpleasant memories. Leave me alone.
No! Don't you see? Now that I've jogged your memory, you can maybe start to get it back. I mean, together we can restore you back to your former state. We can start your life again. And you can go back on the TV studio and you can do your show again, whatever it was, to millions of viewers touching each and every one of their lives. You can be whole again. Oh, Joe, come on. You've got to try. You've got to try to get your memory back.
How do you know my name was Joe?
It's not important. What is important is that we get you on your feet again. Come on, they're waiting for you at the studio.
Now look, lady. Sit down. You have got a few things to learn about the futility of narrowly focused, goal-oriented behavior, okay? Now look, just because you have concocted some subjective goal, I mean, these things, okay, these things are useful for lending some illusion of meaning or purpose to some basically functionless existence, but they don't have any objective meaning in the real world. Just because you've concocted some goal for me to do doesn't mean that it has any impact on other people's lives. It doesn't have any real objective meaning. There are no objective meanings anyway. We just come up with these things that get us by from day to day, but if I don't do the show, it doesn't matter whether I do the show. It doesn't matter. People will live and they will die and they will lead their lives in exactly the same way no matter what I do. It doesn't matter if I sit here and lead the rest of my life in this empty lot with my bottle of wine. I sit here and rot and die. It doesn't matter. Give it up. Get a fucking clue.
I guess you're right. I mean, I've been living my life all wrong. Excuse me. I think I'm gonna go strangle some kittens.
Okay. Wow. Wow, that was great. Wow, that was excellent. With one flip cynical remark, I completely demolished her optimistic worldview. If only I could poison one person like that, just one person every week, my life would be worth living again. I've got to get on television somehow. That's what I got to do. Once a week or so, you know, get on television, and it doesn't matter how. I'll do something in my basement. That's what I'll do. Yeah. I'll just make some stupid show out of my basement and call it This Week in Joe's Basement. Anybody who'd watch that must be really desperate. And, and then I'll get on the air, and here, I know what I'll do. Hang on a sec. Yeah, I'll just come up to people every week, and I'll just throw something together, and it doesn't really matter what it is, and just sit down and good evening and welcome to This Week in Joe's Basement. I'm Joe, and this is my basement. So This Week in Joe's Basement is our 10th anniversary special, a tribute to cigarettes, starring Jengis Elpar as a cigarette man. Before we begin with the show, hang on a second, I'm really hungry here. I'm gonna finish this. I'll be right with you. I wonder how they get this to be so green. Okay. Anyway, I'd like to respond to, our second legitimate piece of viewer mail. Which I have right here from, can you zoom in on this? Mrs. Karen Carrington of 101051 Avenue N. Yeah, see? See that address? See that postmark? That's a real postmark. Listen, I don't know how much it costs to, what's left, right, reversed, to get, you know, a fake postmark, but that's not fake. So, okay. Anyway, so it's an invitation to be on the Bill Fisher Show, which is the show that comes on before this, and I don't have cable, so I have no idea what it's like, but I think it's a talk show. And so I accepted, I'm not exactly sure when it's going to come on, but I'm going to be on the Bill Fisher Show at some point, and I have no idea what we're going to do, but, you know, I'm used to that. So, anyway, that's only the second piece of viewer mail we've gotten that's at all legitimate, and all the other ones came from Jengis. Okay, these catalogs that he ordered so that because he knew he could get them from the tattoo company, and we saw those already in episode 8. So, you know, this post office box cost $24, okay? And this is pretty lame, even for access, you know? I bet the religious programs get more mail than I do. So, this is getting pretty serious here. I mean, there's a definite possibility that, that nobody watches this show at all. I mean, nobody. You know, because none of my friends watch it, and I don't watch it, and the people who regulate the programs at Chicago Access Company don't watch it. You know, so who's left? You know, so I'm starting to lose faith here. But ever forgiving, I'm willing to give you viewers one last chance, and I'm willing to do it in a real substantial way here, which is the first person to write me a genuinely interesting, witty, and clever piece of viewer mail, which I can actually generate some screen time out of, and actually, you know, to have something to do on the show, I'll pay you $20.
Hi. We are not experiencing technical difficulties. You see, what's happened is that the people who enforce the rules at Chicago Access Company do, in fact, watch the tapes. And they've pointed out to me that what I was about to do on this week's show, which was to offer a cash prize to whoever sent in the wittiest piece of viewer mail, that to do that would be strictly unethical and against Chicago Access Company rules and regulations. So I must excise that portion of this week's show, which is offensive. So, well, I've got some time to kill here. I've left the viewer mail address on the screen in hopes that you'll still write in for more altruistic motives. In the meantime, let's have some soothing music and think non-monetary thoughts. All right, so on with the show. This week in Joe's basement, tribute to cigarette smoking. Thank you.
Cigarettes are bad for you. We do not endorse cigarette smoking. We just think it looks cool.
I need a cigarette. Cigarettes.
Hey, how you doing?
You know, I really need a cigarette. So I'd like to buy a pack of cigarettes, please. Here, wait.
Nope. No,
it's just one pack. That's all I need. It's my nickel. No cigarettes. You don't serve cigarettes here?
Nope.
No? Not even one cigarette?
No. Oh, wait, no cigarettes. No.
Okay,
all
right. I'll leave. Where are my cigarettes? I need a cigarette. I need a cigarette now! Hey, excuse me, sir. Sir? I was wondering if I could just, have a cigarette, please?
No! Get out of here!
God, man, I really need a cigarette. I don't care what kind of cigarette it is. I don't care if it's a fucking menthol. I don't care if it's a cool. I don't care if it's a fucking merit. There's gotta be a cigarette around here somewhere. What's wrong with people these days, man? You ask for a cigarette, they act like total jerks. I don't believe this is country. Man, hey, cancer face. Hey, you with the screwdriver. Got a cigarette, man? Oh, God, you're ugly.
No, fuck off.
Oh, fuck you, man. I smell cigarettes! Oh my God! I don't know what's wrong with people these days. Every time I ask for a cigarette, all I get is a fucking lecture.
Good afternoon, and welcome to today's segment of the anti-cigarette lecture series, exploring why cigarettes are bad for you. As you know, there's a psychological dimension as well as a physical dimension to cigarette addiction. You smoke, you pollute your lungs, they rot, pretty soon you can't walk, you lose your sex drive, and eventually your wife leaves you. These are not all bad things, but mostly they are. The peer pressure aspect of it, why do you start smoking? Because your friends smoke when you're a teenager, you think it's cool, your parents smoke, and yes?
Excuse me, Mr. Professor Monster, sir, person. I could really use a cigarette. You have one?
No! Fuck you! Get out of here!
Where are my cigarettes? I want my cigarettes! Now! You know what I hate? It's when people hide cigarettes from me. There's gotta be cigarettes around here someplace.
I know there's
cigarettes. Someplace. Cigarettes! I know you. You're the guy with the cigarettes. So, where are the cigarettes, man? Oh, you're made of cigarettes, man. You look like a fucking cigarette. I want some cigarettes now. Yeah, you. Yeah. In fact, I bet I know where I can find some cigarettes. Ha, ha, ha. All this time, motherfucker was hiding cigarettes from me. What a fucking jerk. Finally, enjoy.
I love cigarettes. I remember the first time I bought a cigarette was when I was 13. God, I got so sick. It's the greatest feeling of my life. I smoked 5 packs that night. It's beautiful. God, the smoke is great. I love the ash too. Fill up with a beautiful smoke.
Yeah, wait a minute. Wait, there was muscle. Well, all this other stuff. It's not supposed to end now. He doesn't get a cigarette yet. Wait. Yeah, Jengis in high place screams, I need a cigarette. Jengis passes more people on the street, found a grand random person, shakes him, demanding a cigarette. Men in white lab coats drag him away. Scene 9. The men in white lab coats place Jengis alone in a large empty room in front of a TV set. They tie him down and they force him to watch images of smokestacks, steam engines, forest fires, burning buildings. Jengis nic-fits. Jengis busts free from his frames and busts free from his chains and he smells cigarettes, so he kills the guards. But a large fleet of space armada, a large fleet of alien spaceships descends, all shaped like cigarettes, and, oh well. Wow, we got some more time to kill, folks, so, well, I had this great tribute to cigarettes all planned out that was just going to, explicate all of Jengis's primal urges as they're directed towards cigarette and really be sort of liberating in how it reveals a side of us that we don't usually like to show, you know? The fact that although we may do things like cigarettes that are grimy and are bad for our health, that you know, the fact that we enjoy them allows us some freedom. Anyway, so, but I can't do that because I can't get Jengis to do any more cigarette stuff. And so, let's go to some film. Let's learn about crowd behavior. That's a good subject for this week in Joe's Basement. Yeah. Mass hysteria and crowd behavior. This week on Joe's Basement. Roll film.
Trying to get that flag off the floor because it's not really supposed to walk on it. Now, if you want to put a Hanoi flag up there, they can walk all over it and throw a few other things on it. What kind of beer? Bush. Yeah, we're from St. Louis. We come up for it. It's warm down there today.
Use a flag as an instrument of art. Especially when the flag is on the floor and people walk on it. It's a disgrace to our country. If you want to fly the flag, put it up on a pole. Don't lay it on the ground. Okay?
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Simple.
Well, that is for the flag, and that's our flag. I fought in Korea for it, and I'll fight for it some more again. If I had to. The flag should not be on touching the floor at all. There's no sense to it.
This flag is a symbol of the U.S. nation, and as such, is not venerated by many black people and other oppressed people around the world. In fact, it is despised.
I think the American people, they're in support of their flag and in support of their country, they should come out. And it is definitely a sight when you see so many people out waving flags in support, you know, of the American country. And I think more and more people should come out anytime something like this happens. America has its problems just like any other country would. But when it does, just like at home with mom and dad, you have to stick by your family, stick by your country. And that's what we're here for.
This, after all, was the flag which was carried by the U.S. cavalry as they massacred the Native American Indians and Mexicans to steal their land. It is the flag which was worn on the shoulders of many policemen as they murder and oppress black people. It is the flag which is painted on the side of Fat Man, the atomic bomb which murdered tens of thousands of people in Hiroshima. This is the flag which, when people rebel internationally, from Palestine to Peru, from South Africa to South Korea, from Vietnam to Iran to the U.S., is one of the first things that is torn. torched.